Hi, I'm John Mattis. Welcome to this taped edition. It's a special edition of Connect With Me on MeTV Fresno on this Wednesday morning. Sorry, no phone calls, but a special program donated. We have to start over. I'm sorry.
Oh,
I know. That's all right.
Okay.
We'll do the second cut.
Stand by. That's good. I'm going to set up the show open.
I almost said live, and I'm so used to saying. Hi, I'm John Mattis. Welcome to this special taped edition of Connect With Me on MeTV Fresno. Showroom floor at Ventura TV on this day. Sorry, no phone calls, but a special program you'll be interested in. It deals specifically with the country of Armenia and animal diseases. That's right, an interesting program. Two guests in the studio. Today's program is sponsored by McHenry Protective Services. Back in a moment. Glad you're with us here on a Wednesday morning. Sorry, no phone calls on this day. It's a special tape program here on Connect With Me on MeTV Fresno. And our thanks to the sponsor, McHenry Protective Services. Been our sponsor for a while here now. Hey, quick programming note before we get started. And that is tomorrow. That would be Thursday morning. We'll have Camille Valentine in. She is a special mediator. So let me explain this. If you're going through a divorce or having some kind of issue with someone else, then Camille Valentine is the one you want to see. She is a mediator. She can help you mediate through the minutiae, all the process that and all the papers that need to be signed to get through whatever difficulties you might be going through at the time. Camille is a very smart individual. She will help you out and will welcome your phone calls tomorrow morning. Then on Friday, we'll have Lee Brand here. He is the mayor-elect. He'll talk about his vision for the city of Fresno for the next 4 years. They may not be the same ideas that Ashley Swearingen had the last 8 years in office, but he'll tell us what his plan is and who will be on his transition team. That's a Friday morning. You'll be able to call in and ask Lee Brand any question that you want. In the meantime, this program, again, a reminder, is a taped version of Connect With Me, but you can watch us live every Monday through Friday, Comcast Channel 375 as usual, except for today, but you're watching us now on tape. Over-the-air broadcast is 43.6 and 13.1, 10 o'clock to 11 o'clock Monday through Friday. Then the replay comes over-the-air broadcast, 2 o'clock in the afternoon, 13.6 U2. And then at 8 o'clock tonight, 4.6 Biz TV. Well, let's get right to our program today, and that is helping the less fortunate, not in this country, but a land that is far, far away from here, especially Fresno. I'm talking about the country of Armenia. That's where a nonprofit organization is helping dairy farmers and helping farmers in general in that country. I want to roll the videotape and show you exactly what I am talking about. That is the focal point of today's program. In this case, the Armenian Technology Group, or ATG, has spent the last 3 years trying to develop the world's most sophisticated mobile veterinary diagnostic laboratories that will help detect any health issues with cows. Keep in mind now, in the country of Armenia, there are a few modern-day roads where one can actually travel from farm to farm. Those areas are mostly undeveloped. Recently, Dr. James Reynolds, the president of ATG, and Varjan Dursimonian, the executive director, traveled to Armenia. With the help from specialists on the ground, they traveled to 14 rural towns and cities, inspecting some of the milk cooling tanks. They visited cattle farms, cheese plants, and regional veterinary centers. This portable lab, which is about the size of a suitcase, my friends, yes, it weighs a lot, but it's the size of a suitcase, can be set up and used in the field on site. to quickly diagnose any type of animal diseases that are present and that can be transferred into humans. Members of ATG also bought and installed 4 large milk cooling containers in the 4 villages in northern Armenia. Now, keep in mind, each cooling tank has the capacity to hold, well, anywhere from 800 to about 1,000 gallons of milk. And over the course of time, more than 3,000 families have stored this milk. The whole purpose of the long trek overseas was for Reynolds and Dersimonian to assess the results of the dairy initiatives and to conduct that testing and to try to minimize the spread of these animal diseases that could easily go into humans. This includes cows, goats, sheep, cattle, swine, whatever the case may be. Live in our studio is Dr. James Reynolds, screen right, and he is the president of ATG. And then right here is Varjan Dersimonian. He is the executive director of ATG. Both are here to talk about this project. It's been many years in the making. They went over to Armenia to try to test this process out. They are here, but they can't take your phone calls. A special tape program here about ATG on Connect With Me on this Wednesday morning. Our sponsor today is McHenry Protective Services. So if you have a problem at home, you want to install a security system or hire a private eye, they are the ones to call. Back in just a moment.
It's no wonder why the City of Fresno and so many Valley businesses choose McHenry Protective and Investigative Services. With over 50 years of experience in public safety and security, McHenry's team of experts will safeguard you, your commercial property, and your next big event. Professional service, marked patrol vehicles, 24-hour dispatch, and friendly, observant, and responsive armed and unarmed guards are just a few of the reasons you should contact McHenry at 559-478-7747 or visit them online at McHenryProtection.com.
Frigidaire. We introduce the first home freezer. The first pulsator agitator washer. And now we introduce the Frigidaire Orbit Clean Dishwasher, designed with a unique wash arm that gives you 4 times more water coverage for a consistently better clean. Frigidaire, over 90 years of legendary innovation. See the full line of Frigidaire appliances at Ventura TV Electronics and Appliances.
Back here on the program with Dr. James Reynolds and Varjan Dersimonian. Varjan, welcome to the program. Good to see you. Dr. Reynolds, good to see you too. How are you?
Excellent. How are you?
Hey, I'm doing fine. How do you like all the chaos here in the studio? Good this morning, huh?
It's good. It's just like being out in the world.
You seem like kind of a quiet, reserved guy. Is he kind of quiet and reserved?
Excellent. He's an excellent guy to travel with, to have fun with, to work with, yes.
He doesn't say much, but I'd like to know what he's thinking.
When the time comes, he does, yes.
Hey, let's roll a piece of videotape of some of these portable labs that we're talking about here during the program. And sorry about that. No phone calls on this day. It's a tape program. So, you know, what are you going to do? Dr. Reynolds, explain what these portable labs are, how they were developed, and what they were designed to do. And you have plenty of time. We have an hour.
Sure. Thanks for the opportunity.
No problem.
Over the years, I've been a cow veterinarian in California and around the world and since about 1982. And when I go places around the world, and I've been working with Armenian Technology Group since the early 1990s with Varjan and other people. When we go to farms in other parts of the world, as a veterinarian, we lack diagnostics. We can see the animals, we can do basic physical exams, but we can't actually make a diagnosis of diseases. And in a place like Armenia, which is a very rural country basically, with a lot of small farms, the animals get sick, but we have to guess at what's actually happening. There is a government central laboratory in the capital, Yerevan, but it's involved mainly in what are called transboundary or foreign animal diseases that are important for crossing borders, and not diseases that are important to the welfare and the productivity.
When you
of
say
animals.
Crossing borders, like where?
The classic example would be foot and mouth disease. A disease that many countries in Europe and North America, we do not have foot and mouth disease. So we spend a lot of time and resources keeping foot and mouth disease out of countries.
So we're looking at the video here, and you're actually testing the milk here, as I understand it. And how is that done specifically here? I'm looking at vials of tube. I imagine you're drawing blood?
So this laboratory is set up to test blood, milk, other secretions, tissue samples. We can take biopsy samples. We can do necropsy exams on dead animals and take samples and look at the make slides and look at the tissue in the slides. We can culture bacteria, and we can do all those different things. So there's different levels. One set of diagnostics that we do would be to go on the farm and see what's causing diseases on the farm, in order to help the animals live better lives and to be more productive, so the family's more profitable. What we're seeing right now is a milk test to see if the cows have mastitis or an infection in the mammary gland. And then the other set of tests that the lab can do is to look at food safety, things in the food that can make people sick.
So what is that solution there? What is that?
That's actually called the California mastitis test. It was developed by the veterinary school UC Davis in the early 1950s. Mm-hmm. And it's a very simple test. We put a sample of milk in one of those wells and put a sample of a reagent in there. And what it does is if there's white blood cells in the milk, it'll cause a reaction to make a gel, a thicker and thicker gel, the more infection is in the tissue, in the mammary gland. That gets in the milk and the white blood cells react with that liquid we put in.
What do you do with the blood that's drawn?
We can look in the blood for some antibody tests. We can look in the blood for direct white blood cell counts to see if an animal has an infection, the white blood cell count will go up. The different types of white blood cells can give us information about what different types of diseases there are in the animals, just like in people. It's exactly the same as in people.
Okay, Varjan, when I said portable labs and it's a suitcase-sized portable lab, people probably have this vision of in their mind that it's a suitcase and it's a laboratory all in one that you're able to travel with and take anywhere that you feel like taking. There it is right there.
Exactly.
Is that it?
Yeah, that's it.
So maybe you can explain what's in this portable size suitcase. It's like a large suitcase. What's in there?
Well, everything. Excuse me. Thanks again for having us, John.
Yeah. Explain what's in there in detail.
Oh, gosh. And let me. what you need to have to test blood, urine, or any other test for the milks and so forth that the animals need. All in one suit. Now, right, Dr. Reynolds, opening it, you'll see all of them right there.
Yeah, look at that. Okay.
Totally, you're talking about 50 pounds, no more than that, and it's very easily transferable, as you see.
So what are the contents here? What do we have? Needles and what else? Vials? What else?
Jim, there's two suitcases. The main suitcase has a microscope, a high-quality microscope, a centrifuge, different kits.
Is that the microscope
there?
That's
the microscope right there.
All right.
We have a centrifuge for spinning blood down to get the serum and the cells separated.
Uh-huh.
We have refractometers to test blood and liquids for different things. The other suitcase has consumables, laboratory tubes, glass slides, culture tubes, culture media, things for culturing and things. There's an incubator in this in the suitcase. We like to take veterinary students with us from the U.S. to help them get trained and working in foreign countries and to work with the veterinarians and veterinary students on farms there.
All right. Now, and let me ask another question here. It doesn't matter who answers this. What is the cost of, and there's the microscope right there. It's just fantastic video here that we're showing to our viewers. Amazing ability to be able to help these farmers in a faraway land, people that need it. What's the cost of one of these portable labs?
What we had calculated, putting it together and training it, is about $15,000.
Okay. Is it free of charge, this testing to the farmers of Armenia?
Education includes that, yes. Yes,
okay.
There's no cost to that. We'll take it there. This is the fourth one, I think, this year. We took it, and then it's free, yes.
It is free of charge to the farmers?
Correct.
All right. Go ahead.
Yes. And what we do is we donate it. ATG donates each lab to a region or a MARS in Armenia, and then that is for use by any farm or veterinarian or the government veterinarians within that region.
Okay. I said before in my monologue that, you know, these farms, these rural farms in Armenia are so far apart. They don't have any modernized or modern day roads to connecting each farm so you can travel easily. How do you get around? And is this one of the main reasons that these portable labs are so vitally important?
Yes, very much so. And it's, as you may see later on in the videos, the travel between one town to the other is kind of difficult.
And how do people get around?
Well, with the cars, of course, you know, they travel. However, it's not convenient for the farmers, particularly in the winter or summertime when the cattle are out in the fields.
But it's the roads are not developed like they are here.
They are
obviously.
Developed, but not as obviously, not as
not it is. Sophisticated it's like very, what we have here.
They're not maintained very well.
Yeah. Gravel, that's dirt.
Now, look at this picture, for example. See, this is we took this in was in June, I believe, and they were taking the cattle up in the mountains. And in the middle of the winter or summer right now, you have some kind of a test, a portable lab, they can take it right up there and do it.
Yeah.
And this is up down in the Sisian region, I believe.
So this is part of the problem is that you have cattle that's, they're blocking the road, you can't get by, right?
It's fun, though.
You get by.
But you have that problem in this country sometimes,
sure.
too.
Part of the reason for the lab is, the lab is actually patterned after what we do here as veterinarians in California or the U.S., as a private veterinarian, I can go to a dairy or any farm, take samples and bring it back to my office, and I can run the tests in my office.
Yeah, but let me ask you this. Okay, there you are testing one of the animals there. So all these animals, they stop in the road and you have to get out. Are the animals just going to, how do you stop an animal and test the animal? And how do you make that animal cooperative?
The in Armenia, the livestock farms tend to be very small. Each person in a village will have several cows or several sheep.
Okay.
And then they are taken out and grazed communally on communal lands.
Are the animals cooperative when you're trying to test them?
And then so they come back to the farmers' homes at night. And so all exams and testing really happen at the farm or at their homes, in the barns.
Okay, but you don't stop and test the animals that are stopped along the highway.
No, if we wanted to do that here or there, then we would set up a portable pen with portable panels, and we could catch each animal individually and test them there that way.
Right.
Same thing as a beef ranch here, we would do that.
All right, you're Armenian, obviously, and very important to you that you help the farmers in Armenia, obviously. Why is this important to you, Dr. Reynolds?
That's a good question. I have always had an interest in helping people anywhere, and helping animals and people, especially livestock animals. I've done many different projects, and commercial and humanitarian projects in different countries as a veterinarian to try to improve the rural economy. So what we really do is by improving the lives and the productivity of animals on these small farms in a country like Armenia, what we're doing is helping improve the economy of that family so they can take care of their children and themselves better, and improving the economy of that village, improving the standards of living for everybody by making the animals better and more healthy.
Yeah. And how many of these suitcase size labs do you have right now?
We took one last year, and based on that, the response was so positive, so we built another three this year. So we have a total of four right now.
You have a total of four labs?
Yes.
At a cost of $15,000 a piece.
Yes.
All right, and I see one of the pamphlets here, you're saying that another $150,000, you need $150,000 more, right?
To go, because we're talking about 10 units, one per region of Armenia. We have 10 counties, so we like to have one per county. Originally, we thought one would be enough sufficient. However, going and visiting there, we realized that having each unit per Mars per county, it should be much more practical, but for governing it and also much more accessible to the farmers locally. So our goal is to have 10 of them total.
Okay, so you have 10 total in 10 counties, right?
That's our intent, yes. Right now we have four. We have six more to go.
Okay. All right. Going to take a break here on Connect With Me. McHenry Protective Services is your sponsor today. Well, actually, it's our sponsor today. But nonetheless, no phone calls. It's a special take program. Back in just a moment.
Protective and Investigative Services. With over 50 years of experience in public safety and security, McHenry's team of experts will safeguard you, your commercial property, and your next big event. Professional service, marked patrol vehicles, 24-hour dispatch, and friendly, observant, and responsive armed and unarmed guards are just a few of the reasons you should contact McHenry at 559-478-7747 or visit them online at McHenryProtection.com.
And away we go.
Here's the place that makes you smile. Stick around and stay a while. We're the home of great TV that's memorable.
that's me.
Follow me, sir.
Call 'em classics, call 'em the best. Call 'em favorites, we are guests. Every day there's more to come. Watch and see, there's only one. Me TV.
All you have to do is watch me.
Are you kidding me?
Follow me.
That's memorable, that's me.
That's me.
Me TV.
Tune in. To
back here on the program,
a tape version of
true country music. So you have to clean up the cows, don't you, in a way, before you can test them?
If we're going to take samples, we always want a clean sample. We don't want to have a contaminated sample. So depending on what we're taking a sample from, if we're getting a milk sample, we have to clean the cow's teats. It's very important. Just like if you're taking a sample from a person, you need a
difficult process, or?
No, it's easy. Once we teach people, it's part of the deal.
What about the people on the ground? Who are you getting help from?
Well, local veterinarians, definitely. No question about it.
Well, talk about that. Explain
well,
that.
It was interesting.
You're getting local people on
yes,
the ground.
Yes, we do. When let's say, for example, last year when we went there, we met
you're getting
the Minister
some
of Agriculture.
Resistance here, by the way. Did you
there
see that
it is.
Kind of?
Yeah, yeah.
Go
that
ahead.
Down in the Goris area, I think, this year. Yeah.
Okay, go ahead.
So we do. We just go out to the veterinarians, the local regional laboratories, and talk to them the benefit of the portable lab. Immediately, the response is very, very positive.
Okay.
And they like to be on-hands experience. So this year, we had a student with us from Western University, Dr. Reynolds student, Haigan Bogosian. She was there, and right now, she's as you see herself right there, she's working and showing.
She's a veterinarian.
Student, yes.
Yeah, a student. Okay.
So the vets locally, they are very positive, especially those who have seen this one before, and right now, they don't have the tools to test it. The response with the portable lab is extremely positive.
And that's the issue, right, Dr. Reynolds, is that you're dealing with a poor country. You're dealing with people that don't have the equipment to complete the kind of testing that you want done. And that's why these portable labs are so important.
Yes.
Did I kind of hit the nail on the head?
You hit it right on the head. It's very important because right now there's no diagnostic ability right on the farm or near the farm. All samples would have to go to the capital Yerevan, which takes time, and they do, and they test for different things. Like I said at the first, they test for important diseases
what kind of diseases are you talking about? Give us the whole landscape of diseases that are out there that could infect some of these cows, cattle, swine,
sure,
that may be transferred to humans. As a matter of fact,
in the case of dairy cows, one of the primary diseases we work with on farms is mastitis, or infection of the mammary gland. Since they give milk, it's important that they have a healthy mammary gland in order to give as much milk as possible.
And if that milk is contaminated and a human drinks that milk, could it be catastrophic?
It could certainly make people sick. Here we pasteurize everything. There, in most countries like Armenia, third world countries, developing countries, most milk is actually processed into cheese or kefir.
Okay.
Because if they drank it raw, then people get sick.
Yeah.
So here we pasteurize milk, and then it's processed into cheese.
And they don't do that there.
They don't pasteurize milk there routinely. There is a fluid milk or bottled milk, and there are pasteurizing systems there. One of the reasons we went in before is several years ago, ATG, and we donated and installed bulk tanks, milk tanks, refrigerated milk tanks, to collect milk from villages so that it would stay refrigerated and it wouldn't spoil as quickly, so they could market it better and keep people more healthy.
Yeah.
So this lab can go to those tank collection areas and test the sanitation of the tanks and the equipment used to store the milk.
All right, I want to run another piece of videotape. It's called Blood Drawn. Okay, you're drawing blood here. When the videotape comes up, you can describe exactly, you know, what we're looking at here. Is this I guess it's not that difficult a process. Does the cow just, or any animal there, the sheep or whatever, they just sit there and just let you draw the blood?
Well, they're captured in different ways. These are fairly tame animals because they're housed close to people in their small farms.
Okay, I feel the pinch of the needle when they're drawing my blood.
Sure, and so
Is that what they're feeling?
Sure, same thing. It's the same needle, same everything, same pain,
yeah.
Same pain, same needle.
Yeah, yeah, but yeah. They don't really flinch, huh?
Well, they flinch, but we do certain things to keep their mind off of it.
Okay.
Just like I have to have somebody tell me it's okay because I don't like needles.
Yeah. Oh, I don't either. But what's going on here?
I palpated that cow to see if she was pregnant.
Okay.
We do rectal palpations to feel their uterus.
Right. Right, and so you're able to determine that right on the spot. And what are we seeing here now? This is much of the same process, right?
This is a one local cow that was caught for us to do an exam on. Mm-hmm. The Haigon, the veterinary student, is doing an exam right now.
Mm-hmm. Mm-hmm. So how many animals would you say are on each farm on average?
Anywhere from 4 to 10 or 20.
Not that much, huh?
No, unless you go to dairy farms and it gets bigger.
There are commercial farms in which there are 50 to 200 or 300.
How many of
cows.
Those commercial farms are in existence there, would you say? Not as many as here.
Exactly. I'm hard to say that. I cannot give you a number right now, no.
10 to 20.
But there are, is it safe to say there are more private farms than there are commercial?
They're all private, but there are...
No, you know what I mean.
Yeah. It's so that by far there are more small farmers
than there are commercial.
And yes. What the small ones, the villages are built around... people having 2 to 10 cows in a barn in their backyard, and then they are taken out every morning and communally grazed, and then brought back at night and put back into their right.
When did this process start, Varjan?
It was in 1992 when our founding father, Dr. Hazar Abedian, as a veterinarian himself, had a goal of building a central diagnostic lab, and the goal was, of course, to build that in Yerevan and serve the entire country. However, over the years, we came to the conclusion that even if we build that, which is quite expensive, $5 million, we will have a hard time to maintain it and also to service it, both locally or even with the local resources. So about 4 years ago, when Dr. Reynolds recommended for us to come over with this portable lab, it took about 3 years, I would say, right, Jim, to test this in various places, here in California, in Mexico, in bordering cities, in the United States.
Oh, you went to Mexico, too?
Yeah. Was it two years ago?
We tested it before we went over to Armenia.
So because we have to make sure when you're taking over there, you're getting something in a complete situation.
Did you test it here in the Central Valley?
Southern California, in the more rural areas of Southern California.
Yeah.
Small farms similar to...
Is there any kind of system in place here in this country that has a portable lab, or how is our testing done in this state, for example, or diseases, animal diseases? How do we test?
Many of the basic things can be done at a veterinarian's office, a cow veterinarian's office, or a small animal. We use a microscope.
What office is that again?
A veterinarian's office. When I was a practitioner, practitioner, I would get blood samples and look at white blood cell counts in the microscope in my office. I would get milk samples and culture them to see what kind of bacteria were causing mastitis. Those types of things can be done in office, and that's exactly what the lab can do there. That technology doesn't exist in Armenia and many countries yet. And then the other tests that can be done, we have kits. We can look at what causes diarrhea in calves, to find out what kind of virus or bacteria is causing diarrhea, so we can treat them better and prevent the diseases better. We can take samples of tissue and make slides.
We don't need portable labs in this country because
the basic things are done in our veterinary offices, and then we also have a very, very large and modern laboratory system in California to provide samples. So veterinarians send samples to the diagnostic labs. There's actually
and
one in Tulare.
And you probably know the results within just maybe a few days, a week or so, right?
Three to 4 days we get the results. If we send the results, the laboratory sample or our farm samples to the lab in Yerevan, the capital of Armenia, it would take 3 to 4 weeks to get a result.
Yeah, you just don't have the diagnostic and the lab, diagnostic labs that you have here.
We don't have the structure, infrastructure.
The infrastructure for that,
Then, in the meantime, if you're waiting for the results, the disease, if they are the transmissible, they're going to be passed on to the other dairies.
While you're waiting.
Right. And, of course, that's going to be economic disaster for the villagers.
Yeah.
So that's why the portable lab having right on the site gives you great advantage for the villagers and the dairy farmers to address the needs.
All right. Should we take a break here? 436 MeTV option 11 if you want to leave a message. That's all you can do today because we're a tape program today. Back tomorrow, of course, live here with Camille Valentine. She's a mediator. And then back again live on Friday with Lee Brand. He is the mayor-elect here in the city of Fresno. We'll see what his plans are to outline all of the problems that need taking care of under his guidance and leadership the next 4 years here in the Central Valley. We're back after this from McHenry Protective Services, our sponsor today.
It's no wonder why the City of Fresno and so many Valley businesses choose McHenry Protective and Investigative Services. With over 50 years of experience in public safety and security, McHenry's team of experts will safeguard you, your commercial property, and your next big event. Professional service, marked patrol vehicles, 24-hour dispatch, and friendly, observant, and responsive armed and unarmed guards are just a few of the reasons you should contact McHenry at 559-478-7747 or visit them online at McHenryProtection.com.
When you're looking for Whirlpool innovation and quality, who has the answers, the selection, the price? Ventura TV Appliance. With billions in nationwide appliance buying power, more than Home Depot and Best Buy combined, we'll help you save. Our low prices on Energy Star qualified Whirlpool appliances save you energy and money, and pay no interest on select models when paid in full within 12 months. Ventura TV Appliance, serving you since 1951.
Okay, back here on the program, no phone calls on this day. This is a taped version of Connect With Me on MeTV Fresno. Of course, you're watching us on Comcast 375, 13.1, and 43.6. You can watch the replay of this program later on in the day at 2 o'clock and 8 o'clock tonight. So Dr. James Reynolds is here. He is the president of ATG, and Varjan Dersimonian, who is the executive director. Explain what ATG is, first of all. What is it? I know what it stands for. It stands for Armenian Technology Group. But what do you guys do? What's your objective?
Our focus is to help the farmers to become self-sufficient. Basically,
in Armenia.
At
okay,
the
not
moment,
here,
yes.
But in Armenia.
Correct.
Okay.
This was established after the earthquake in 1989, if you recall.
Right.
And since then, we've done, our focus has been on agriculture and rural development, because a lot of nonprofit organizations who came forward to help Armenia, and we thought that since there was a gap right there, the need for the agricultural development, specifically in the dairy farms, that's why we focused our interest on that.
Are there still people in Armenia, farmers specifically, maybe, that are still have not fully recovered from the 89 quake?
Around the city of Gyumri, yes. There are people who have not totally recovered yet. In the farming community, yes, they are surviving, but definitely there's a big, big difference in economic levels, may say, between the capital city and the rural Armenia.
Yeah.
There's a huge difference between the economic development in the city compared to the rural area.
Yeah, I mean, it's been, what, 27 years?
Yeah.
And they still are kind of reeling a little bit, huh?
Right. And where the epicenter was, yes, that's actually taking a long time. It's if you didn't know there was an earthquake, you probably wouldn't see some of the long-term effects.
What are some of the long-term effects, in your opinion?
Resettlement of people. There's a lot of
infrastructure.
Yes,
the rebuilding.
Yes. Right.
Housing, infrastructure, all that.
Yes. Sure.
Yes.
Transportation.
That's getting better. Much better, I would say, than before. Yes.
Yeah, and so ATG helps in all these other areas.
We do focus on basically on farm, helping the farmers themselves directly. Rather than giving them a charity, our goal is to make them sustainable, to make them powerful enough to provide to their family. It is not just handout, it is educating them through seminars and field demonstrations, be that in the diagnostic lab, the wheat farm, and other thing areas that we've focused. And I would say over the last 20-some years, we've got more about 380 seminars throughout the countryside.
Let's roll a videotape. I want to take a videotape called Taking Cultures. We haven't seen this yet. Probably best for our other guest here,
sure.
To talk about these cultures. What are we looking at here, Dr. Reynolds?
That's a Petri dish with a milk sample spread on it, and each one of those dots is a colony of bacteria. We can look at the colony, the bacteria, and we can diagnose what type of bacteria is in the milk coming from the mammary gland.
So how do you diagnose it?
So that's how we diagnose it. We look at the colonies and we say it's Staphylococcus, it's Streptococcus, it's E. coli, it can be a Klebsiella. There's different kinds of bacteria that can cause mastitis in cows or sheep or goats. We can do the same thing with different species of animals. And then we can prescribe treatments. We can come up with prevention strategies. And some of the, we can determine if it's, the milk is safe for people to drink.
So it's, and in most cases, is it safe to drink? Or in most cases, are you finding diseases? That's the other question I didn't ask.
Well, most diseases animals get are not diseases that transfer to people, which is fortunate. Otherwise, we'd always be sick. Some of the diseases that make animals sick make us sick, and some of the diseases we get make them sick.
But are most of the animals that you're testing, are they sick?
No, and in the case that, in the case that we were, when we take the lab to Armenia, we don't see too many sick animals because we're coming in at a certain time. The laboratory is there for the for them to use. Then we donate it, and it's then for the whole year, so that when there is a disease outbreak or sick animals on a farm, then the veterinarian can go there, get the samples, and either test them directly on the farm or at his office.
On average, how many? What's a percentage of animals that you're finding that, that they do have something wrong?
About 20 to 40% of the cows will get mastitis during a lactation, so that's important.
Okay.
About 20 to 30% of calves when they grow, actually more in Armenia, probably 40 or 50% will get pneumonia. The majority of calves when they're being grown will get diarrhea for different reasons. So it's important to test those types of things. Also, these animals are in Armenia are always on pasture. They're pastured, which is good. It's a good way to harvest the grass and turn it into useful proteins for people. But they will get parasites on the pasture. And so this laboratory can take a sample of blood or feces and test to see what types of parasites, if they have parasites, how many parasites and what types of parasites. So, and the parasites are not typically transferable to people, but they do impact the animal's health and well-being and productivity.
Yeah.
So the direct thing we do with the lab is test milk and test milk at the collection points for sanitation to make, at the collection points is where the food safety part comes in.
Right.
Because if it sits for very long, then different kinds of bacteria grow in it.
But you got to make sure too that, you know, most of these diseases that are transferable to humans does not reach the human chain. How do you do that? Is that a difficult process? And the other thing is, if how many cases do you run into where, and by the way, let's roll a videotape while I'm asking that question, testing the blood. How many of these cases where you find, okay, we found some really bad diseases in this cow, we're going to have to put it down? Does that ever happen?
That happens. The majority of those kinds of diseases are government regulatory diseases. Brucellosis is one. Tuberculosis is another. Foot and mouth disease is another. The foot and mouth disease doesn't transfer to people. Those diseases, if found, then the government takes over and will purchase the animal and slaughter or euthanize the animal to control the disease in the groups. What we're looking for with our lab is are more diseases that are common on the farms, so that we can develop control procedures, and diseases that might make it into the milk or the food chain.
So they're a little bit less on the scale in terms of seriousness.
They're less serious because the real serious ones, by definition, have to be government ones for regulatory purposes.
Okay.
And we don't really want to interact that. We want to work directly with the farms and the farmers and the local veterinarians to help the lives of the animals and the productivity of the animals and thus the lives of the community.
Yeah. How do you, is it difficult to prevent that transfer of disease from animal to humans?
It's not difficult. But the simple procedures are often overwhelmed. It's all about sanitation, washing your hands, and keeping feces away from people. And in small farms and villages, there's more interaction with things like that.
Go ahead, Varshan. You want to chip in
here? No, I'm just going to ask him to explain what the blood test we're doing right there.
So in this video, we've taken blood from the cows and some sheep. We took blood from sheep, and we spin the blood down to separate the clear part of the serum away from the cells and the red part. This is a refractometer, a clinical refractometer. We put that on there to see the level of protein in the blood. And the level of fluid in the blood.
Mm-hmm.
We're showing the local government veterinarians, laboratory veterinarians, how to use the equipment as we go. We have two different kinds of refractometers in the lab, an electronic one and a handheld one like that.
Okay.
And the same thing for testing urine to see if the kidneys are working well in the animal or if there's an infection in the urine.
Go ahead.
No, that's fine.
Yeah, I know. I was gonna ask you. So, what kind of return are you seeing on your investment?
Well, the one indication for sure when we took the first one last year, in response from the people that they do need to have, and we realized that they need it. And when we took the three more this year, and I'm not sure later on when we see one of the videos upon our return early, end of May. We had a meeting with the local veterinarians, the head office, the central lab, and they're the one who basically evaluated the first model and gave us a feedback how happy they were. Yeah. That gave us encouragement for us to go further and do even more. And that's how, based on their recommendation, our finding, we did deliver the other three. And those three labs, there's a blood test there. The three lab, Jim, you want to explain what that is?
Well, the lab comes set up to work in the field without power, so it has a handheld centrifuge like that, so we don't have to worry about electricity. And then it also comes with solar panels, so we can use the electronic things, the microscope and the incubator with the solar panels, and we can also plug it into cars.
How many people? Go ahead.
That's the meeting where we had with the local head of the central laboratory, and they gave us an update on the needs. He is the chief veterinarian in the country. So his evaluation was a very good indication to us that this kind of a laboratory is excellent service to the local community, not only in Armenia, but it could be used anywhere in the world, of course. It is a plus for the veterinarians, to humanity as well. So we took the other three, one to the Gymri, the other second one in Lori, and the third one in the Goris region. Those are bordering counties
in
Armenia.
Northern Armenia?
Two of them in northern Armenia, one in south of Armenia, bordering Iran, the two, Georgia and Azerbaijan and Turkey, and one central was in Yerevan. The whole intent was, of course, to try to minimize transfer from outside to the country.
Now, this video came from the one of the local stations there, the networks in Armenia. Is that true?
Correct. Yeah, and that's where there was, I think it was our second day when we were there, when we met the locals to evaluate the lab, to get their feedback, and the local media was invited to themselves to hear it, and obviously they broadcast it locally several times.
How many people on the ground helping you guys from Armenia? How many people, when you go, does it vary from farm to farm?
Sure. Each county, I would say, they have their own central labs, not as, of course, sufficiently developed.
But I mean,
as
on any
here.
Given day that you went to, say, a farm, would you have 5 people, 10 people helping you, or not that many, or what's the average?
That's about 5 to 10 people in each of the region. Particularly now, remember, he is an epidemiologist right now. He's giving his evaluation. Chief epidemiologist in the country.
Okay.
Dr. Magarchan. He's the one who basically gave his own feedback. Back to your question that how many people we meet, 5 to 10. And remember, when we take the labs there, first we focus on the local veterinarians and the government control labs to train them first. And they're the one who are going to go out and start working with the local veterinarians.
Mm-hmm.
So,
interesting. All right. Well, we're going to take a break. We'll come back and talk a little bit more about the trip to Armenia and what else is going on in the world of farming over there. You might be interested in that. No phone calls today. Hey, if you want to call the phone line at 436-ME-TV option 11, that's the normal call-in number. You can leave a message or you can just watch our program right now or watch the replay at 2 o'clock in the afternoon, 8 o'clock tonight. Today's program sponsored by McHenry Protective Services. It is a tape program, so no phone calls back in a moment.
It's no wonder why the City of Fresno and so many Valley businesses choose McHenry Protective and Investigative Services. With over 50 years of experience in public safety and security, McHenry's team of experts will safeguard you, your commercial property, and your next big event. Professional service, marked patrol vehicles, 24-hour dispatch, and friendly, observant, and responsive armed and unarmed guards are just a few of the reasons you should contact McHenry at 559-478-7747 or visit them online at McHenryProtection.com.
When you like Ventura TV Appliance on Facebook, it's nice. But when you love the KitchenAid appliances we deliver, it's even better. Our website is cool, and it's a good place to start. But you really should touch the merchandise before you buy. Save big with KitchenAid. Right now, get up to a $1,000 prepaid MasterCard when you purchase select KitchenAid appliances. Get the best selection, price, and service in town without waiting. Come in to Ventura TV Appliance and touch the merchandise today.
The Ballad of Andy and Barney. Andy and Barney were lawmen, bravest you ever did see. Warned every crook in the record book to stay out of Mayberry. They were the law.
Yes, they were the law, and they didn't know fear.
The Andy Griffith Show.
I guess to sum it up, you could say there's three reasons why there's so little crime in Mayberry. There's Andy, and there's me, and baby makes three.
Now on MeTV Fresno.
We're back here on this tape version of Connect With Me on MeTV Fresno. And Dr. James Reynolds is here. He's the president of ATG. Varjan Dursimonian is the executive director. How old is ATG? How many years now?
27 years.
27 years since the earthquake, obviously. Yes, yes. It was formed by you and some other people. And so if people are looking at this program today and they say, you know what? And there are a lot of Armenians that watch this program and a lot of Armenians that live here in the Central Valley. But you don't have to be Armenian if you want to help out and donate. So how do people do that?
Well, they can talk to us directly. Our phone number is 224-1000 here in Fresno, 559-224-1000. Or they can send
slow that number down just a little bit.
559. I say this so often, I guess I go so fast.
I know. Just a little slower.
559-224.
Okay.
1000.
224-1000 if you want to call and donate.
We made that number simple enough so we can remember our later on.
Gosh, so, even I can remember that. Okay, go ahead.
Yes, people can make a donation. They can send it to check to us, and we'll be happy to provide them the addresses when they call. The issue is this is not only something that can Armenians benefit in Armenia, however, in other places as well. If there are other members or in the community who like to see this kind of a lab being delivered to other parts of the world, for example, Central America or poorer countries, we'll be more than happy to help them. This is something that all people can benefit, not only Armenians. I think Dr. Reynolds will agree on that. Right, Doctor?
Wherever I go, there's a need to have a laboratory local and close by that we can count on.
All right, we got a video slideshow of the no-till farming, and explain what this is. When you talk about no-till farming, and why is this important, and what is it exactly? People want to know what this is. Here it is right here in Armenia. Northern Armenia, by the way?
Yes, it is. Northern Armenia.
Okay, well, what's going on here?
We are changing the subject a little bit, of course, here. This is the wheat fields that we have started years ago. Uh-huh. Wheat project we started in 1992. In the last 7-8 years, we changed it to no-till farming. In no-till farming, as you see, these are two fields. You're going to see two pictures here. You don't till the soil.
Because
the benefit of it is that by not tilling the soil, you're not disturbing the ground, so you're saving about 25% of your moisture in the soil. Number two, you're helping the soil to develop its own nitrogen inside of it. So the benefit, direct benefit to the farmer is 65% saving on their cost. It's reduction of their operating cost. Because number one, you're not using your farm equipment as many times. With one tillage, you can plant the seed, provide the fertilizer, and thus saving on your equipment, fuel, and time.
So 25%
of your water.
Of your moisture stays in the ground if you do not
till it.
Till.
Of course, now this is a farming system. That means that by not tilling the soil, the farmer will face some new challenges, especially.
So they're not using their equipment as often either, so they're saving money there.
Right. Yes, and of course what will happen here, by not tilling the soil, you're gonna face some other challenges by how to control the weed. So what we have recommended to the farmers, if they, let's say they have 100 acres, not to convert completely to no-till, however go 20% at a time, because it's gonna come time that the soil to get adapted to the no-till farming, it will take 3 to 4 years. The first 4 years are going to have very good results. Afterwards, of course, going to go down and go up again. So by spreading the conversion from regular tillage to no-till 20% at a time. At the end of the 5 or 6 years, the farm will not lose their income.
How often is this used in this country?
In Midwest and the East is very much so. Not in California. In Midwest, heavily.
Heavily in the Midwest and in the East.
In this, yes. Not in the West Coast.
Not in the West. Not here in California, certainly. Right, yeah. Not here in the Central Valley.
Mm-hmm.
Yeah, they do it here quite often. Would there be a benefit in doing it here?
Well, I believe so. I think the farmer here themselves, they can judge themselves it's going to be beneficial for them or not. Of course, water is a big issue here. They have to be the judge themselves. In case of the wheat fields in Armenia, this is very helpful to them.
How is it making it different in terms of the outcome of the product, Dr. Reynolds?
Well, Verjan's our wheat expert. I'm the cow expert.
All right, but in terms of the final product that reaches your table, all right. Does it make a difference?
No.
Nutritionally?
No. Here is a picture for you, for example. If you look at this picture, this was done a few years ago comparing our field, which is on the right side, and with the domestic seed variety, which is the right on the right is rust resistant, the one on the left has it infected, so the farmer is losing their farm. This is how we do our demonstration farms. We plant right next to the existing farm technologies and farm system. We don't argue with the farmer, we just to show them how it is that we do here in the States or in the West. By the farmer seeing it next to each other, they can see right there. The one on the left definitely has no income at the end of the harvest, where the one on the right does have an income. And this is the, of course, it's the years of experience that we're having. This picture was in 2010. In a no-till farming this year, if we have a picture there, we'll show that also. It's same way, we plant a no-till right next to the existing regular farming. And the farmer themselves can tell the difference. Later on, if you can show me the other pictures when the gentleman is holding the wheat,
But I'm not going to be able to have, won't be able to tell the difference once the food reaches my table.
There's no difference. There's none whatsoever. The taste is the same. The
nutritionally, it's the same.
Yes, here it is. Look at this one. This is a no-till system. See how look at the vigorness on the green, right? And the other one, which is kind of curling when it comes to the tillage, because what's happening here, you have more moisture, so the plant's having more moisture, has more strength to it. With the regular one, of course, you see the stress on the level. Now here, look at the fields on the left and the right. We could not tell which one is a no-till, which one is the regular. So we asked our farmer to have his thumbs up and thumbs down. So the thumbs up is the no-till farming, thumbs down is the standard regular farming.
Keep that picture up there right now. Okay, so, you flipped it. What's going on? Okay. All right. Right there.
Yes. Can you tell the difference between left and right?
I can't tell the difference right there, but let me ask you. Okay,
yes.
Screen right is the no-till.
Mm-hmm.
Am I right?
To your right, yes.
Screen right.
Yes.
Okay, folks at home, if you're looking to the right-hand side of your screen, that's the no-till farming on the wheat fields. And on the left is
regular. Regular.
So there's less tractor turns around the field, less fuel used, the ground, the ground is not broken up and the moisture dissipated. So there's less cost to the no-till. It's fewer passes around the field to get the wheat planted. And,
right.
and over time, the soil builds up and has more nutrients for the seeds in the soil itself.
But with the naked eye, you can't tell.
No, that's right.
They're both green.
It's just it's more efficient to produce with the no-till.
The only difference. It's more efficient.
Yes.
That's what it boils down to in simple terms.
And here it is, Dr. Alex Morganov with the glasses there, and Mkhitar on the center, and Gagik, our head director in Armenia, examining no-till farming up north in northern Armenia. This is, again, our field, Jim and myself, in the fields, again, no-till farming. Dr. Morganov is a vice president of the International Wheat and Maize Organization, CIMMYT, based in Mexico, and the second headquarters in Turkey. He came to evaluate the wheat fields. We've been working with them for the last 20-plus years, taking wheat samples. And what we do when we take the wheat samples, we test them in various locations throughout Armenia. Remember, Armenia has 7 growing zones, so each zone has its own adaptability need.
Why don't they do the no-till in California?
Most possibly the cost to the farmers. They have to be the judge themselves. If they find that it's beneficial to them, they will
But if it uses 25% less or there's 25% more moisture in the ground that's left in the ground. Considering our drought situation, wouldn't that help?
John, I think what it really comes down to, and in California, our farms here, because it's irrigated and we have a long season, we tend to have two or three different crops planted. No-till works really well where you're doing in an area that's dependent on rainfall only, and there's one harvest per year.
How often does it rain in northern Armenia?
It rains a lot, but again, the growing zone is only very short.
So, like, our American Midwest grows the one crop of corn or one crop of soybeans, basically.
Here we're growing several.
Here we grow multiple. Two or three multiple crops, and so you're going to have so farmers in California are a different thing. We're tilling the soil more for different crops.
Yeah.
But where there's only one crop per year, the no-till works in quite well.
Interesting. I wish this was a live show today, but unfortunately.
We'd be happy to answer.
I know. Just what's the telephone number again? 224-1000.
Please give us a call, either myself or Dr. Reynolds. We'll be happy to talk to you either on no-till and or the portable diagnostic lab.
Okay. And if you do have a question or a comment, you can leave it on our answering machine here, our service, 436-ME-TV, option 11. It'll go directly to voicemail. Change topics again. Let's go to the grape nurseries. What's going on in the industry of grapes?
Well,
in Armenia.
Armenia has been suffering with the phylloxera pest, which is in the ground right now, that basically kills the wheat, grape fields.
Okay, what is it again?
Phylloxera.
Okay.
Which we had here in California with the Napa Valley. Throughout the world, you had that pest. Which
same
is
problem.
Yes. And eventually, the only way that you can definitely save the vineyards is the providing phylloxera resistant rootstocks. So in 1998, we took 5,400 rootstocks from California to Armenia and planted in Carapal. We established.
Where is this?
This is in our Yerevan.
Okay.
We set up the new one because last 4 or 5 years we saw the spread of disease throughout the Ararat Valley. You're talking over 10,000 hectares, about almost 25,000 acres of wheat grape fields in Armenia, which is infected by phylloxera.
And it kills the grapes.
It kills the grapes right from the roots, right inside. What happens, kind of pokes. This is the field we're going to establish the new nursery. It was pokes into the roots of the vines, and the vine cannot get the nutrition needed to sustain itself. So what we have to do, we have to set up a nursery that provides wild roots, which is the rootstock itself, and graft the local varieties onto those phylloxera-resistant rootstocks. And that's what we're doing right now there. By the way, this is the no-till tractor the planter that we had from Kansas up in Armenia.
Okay.
That's in northern Armenia.
Okay.
But back to the grape program. The goal is to establish the nursery and provide the cuttings to the farmers again. If we don't start now, within the next 4 to 5 years, that's going to spread so much that you're going to lose the whole basic income of the farmers that are based on the vineyards.
That's
and
amazing.
We're talking major disaster. Ararat Valley is one of the oldest the valleys in the world. It is the oldest. If you look at the Noah's Ark, when Noah came down from Ararat, the first thing he did is planting vines. And those vines has been there for all the years. The people are used to that. They have the wine and the cognac, all based, of course, on grapes. And our thought was, if we're going to wait for the disease to spread and kill the entire vineyards, we're going to be too late. So that's why we start the vineyards and the nursery now. Hopefully, within next year or two, we'll have a solid production line that we can provide to the farmers.
Well, we got about a minute left here on this tape version of Connect with Me, and so anything else you'd like to add, because you got 30 seconds and then we got to go, but
well,
go ahead.
I would say thank you again, John. This was very good. I appreciate you inviting us. We had the opportunity to share this with our supporters.
Thank you. And the telephone number again is 224-1000.
1000.
All right. Dr. James Reynolds, always good to see you.
Thanks for coming in. Appreciate it.
You got a big trip coming up. But
thank you so much.
Dr. Reynolds and Barjon Dursimonian. Okay, so tomorrow it'll be another live program. Camille Valentine will be here. She is a mediator. You might need one someday, my friends. You know, we need one here at Ventura TV to mediate all of our television problems behind the scenes. No, I'm just kidding. Anyway, we don't have any problems here. We deliver the program each and every day. Then on Friday, Lee Brand, the new mayor-elect. See you then. Goodbye. Have a good day.